what happens when you have complications after a surgery? In this video, I'm going to talk with Diana, a stage 4 colorectal cancer survivor that has had a surgery I had never heard of before called Gracilis flap. She'll explain the complications that she had from her initial surgery and why doctors thought that Gracilis flap surgery would help. For those of you that are new here, my name is Jelena and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer in 2016. After a year of surgeries and treatment, I was declared cancer-free and I've had no evidence of the disease or been considered NED ever since. I created this channel to help others going through a cancer diagnosis feel a little less alone out there, and also to help you better understand what to expect along the way from a patient's perspective. Now let's talk with Diana. Hi Diana, welcome to my channel.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining me today. I want to get started with our interview by having you just tell us a little bit about yourself before cancer.
So, you know, right before diagnosis, I had 3 small kids. We were moving and I was mostly a stay-at-home mom, but I did real estate on the side just to kind of keep my head above water and my foot in something, because I had 3 little kids and I felt like sometimes you feel like you're losing yourself a little bit, but at the same time, they were my life. And things were a little bit stressful. You know, my husband had just gotten a new job and we were preparing for a big move and in a community that we loved, and we were leaving, and what, you know, we had become, had kind of a community that had become our family, and we were about to leave that. So it was a stressful time. And so even some of the symptoms that I had at the time were all kind of chalked up to stress, unfortunately.
Can you share a little bit more about your symptoms and your diagnosis?
Sure. So at right around the time that my husband had, you know, gotten an interview at another university, I was noticing small symptoms of loose stool that slowly turned into narrow stool. And it was kind of a daily thing. And I thought, you know, like any other person, oh, it's just, I drank too much coffee or I'm just nervous. But those things being nervous or anxious never used to affect me in that way. But I thought, well, maybe I'm just changing, getting older. My body is working differently. You know, and I think as a mom, a lot of women only see their OBGYN, which is what I did. I remember going to my OBGYN and saying, like, what's going on? And she's like, you are dealing with stress. Like, you've got your home with your 3 kids a lot. Your husband is out of town. And I remember just breaking down in tears because I was so stressed. And I was like, yeah, that sounds about right. Yeah. And she's like, you're just eaten up with emotion right now. Like, once your life calms down, this will all calm down. But then we moved. And when we moved, the symptoms kept growing. And that was from around June. And we moved in November. And then, you know, little things would happen, like a family pet got hit by a car, a family cat died. There was like little things that said, well, stress is still coming. So I guess that makes sense that I'm still dealing with these stomach issues. But by Christmas, I started noticing a considerable amount of blood in my stool. And then by the time January came, it was so bad that I thought, oh my gosh, am I going to need a blood transfusion? And my husband said, you really need to go to the doctor. And we knew no doctors here. I just scheduled it with the first doctor that, you know, allowed me in. And of course, that was a waiting game. So they didn't get me until the end of January. And that doctor was sure, because of my age, which was 36, that you are dealing with Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, one of the two, because of your age, and this is probably all brought on by stress. It sounded like that made complete sense. And she's like, these symptoms are all very similar and we're going to get you, you know, to a doctor and this will all get taken care of. There's medication to help this. And I thought, that makes sense. You know, sounds like what I'm dealing with. So they got me into, a gastro doctor. And at that time, we knew no one in the new town we were in, except for a few people at my husband's job. We'd been snowed in most of the winter, so I hadn't met anyone. And so this was when I finally got to that doctor in February. He saw me and he said, I'm going to set you up for a colonoscopy. And we brought all three kids along with us, who one wasn't in school yet. The other two had just started a brand new school and we didn't know anybody to pick them up. So we said, why don't we just all go together? We'll make a day of it. Unfortunately, when they got me back there and they did the colonoscopy, they did find that their words were a tumor and it was malignant in appearance. And so the nurses ended up babysitting the kids in the waiting room while they told me and my husband that they were going to rush a biopsy and that it didn't look good. So we spent the entire car ride home, an hour and a half home, in complete silence and in fear, and while the kids were in the background being kids. So those were my symptoms leading up to my diagnosis.
Oh my. Okay. So then after you found out that the tumor was in fact cancer, what did your treatment plan look like?
So originally I think, how it happened was I got the biopsy like pretty much next day, and in which case they did say that it was malignant. And we were immediately sent to a surgeon, and that surgeon is the one who suggested our oncologist. And so there were a slurry of, you know, meetings with my new surgeon and my oncologist, in which case they originally had planned surgery first, but once they were trying to determine, there was a day in which we had so many different scans, MRIs all put into one day, and they wanted to make sure that the rectal tumor hadn't grown into the vagina and through the vaginal wall. There was a lot of testing that happened. And then once they determined a few different things, they decided to start with chemo and then radiation. So it was 3 months of chemo. And then every 2 weeks, full FOX was the treatment. And then I did 5 weeks of radiation after I had a small break from chemo. And then my surgery was a few weeks. It was more like a few months after radiation, and then we continued with more chemo afterwards.
Okay. So I think we kind of skipped over this, but you were diagnosed stage four.
Initially. Yes. Yes. I was diagnosed stage four. They were not thinking I was stage four at first. I think they thought stage three, but they attempted to do a biopsy on the spots in the liver, and it was a CT guided biopsy, but they realized the spots were too close to the diaphragm and too close to the lungs, and that they could puncture the lungs. So they decided not to, and the oncologist was 99% sure that they were cancer or spread from that. So we went forward with the idea that it was stage four, and then it did turn out that it was stage four.
Okay. Well, can you tell us what your initial surgery entailed?
So my initial surgery was the LAR surgery, the lower anterior resection, and a permanent colostomy. So basically resecting the tumor in the rectum, and everything surrounding that was removed as well. And due to the location of the tumor, being so low and in the rectum, they knew that they couldn't save anything, and I would get a permanent colostomy. They would not be able to do a reversal. I got the colostomy as well as the LAR surgery all at the same time. And they determined, you know, some people, there's a choice to get, or some surgeons decide that they want to do a flap at that time, whether it's from the abdomen or the Gracilis flap, which is the leg. I think there's a few other options too, but they determined because of my age that I likely would heal from the LAR surgery, and I would have what a lot of people refer to as a Barbie butt. So it would close up and it would be sealed shut. Unfortunately, that didn't happen for me, but that is that was my initial surgery, which took me quite a bit of time to heal from, longer than normal. I believe they say it's a 6 to 8 weeks, but it was way past the 8 weeks, and they decided they couldn't wait any longer and started me on chemo anyway, even though I was barely walking after that surgery. It was just a really rough recovery for me, which I do believe had a lot to do with my radiation and how I handled radiation. My body struggled to heal internally after radiation.
So then how did you know that something was wrong or wasn't healing right after your surgery?
Every time I'd go in there, I think, you know, I went in for several different appointments, just post-surgery appointments, checking the wound, and it was still draining. And then, of course, they just said, well, we'll just give it more time and give it more time, in which we did, but it never did close up. And I would have to wear a pad. I still do, for drainage, which is just, you know, I know it sounds weird when I say drainage, but the way I explain it and the way it's been explained to me is, if you scrape your, you know, knee or your hand or whatever on, if you're out riding a bike and you fall, it's the clear lymph liquid that, that comes out of a wound. It's just constantly draining, trying to heal, trying to scab, trying to mend together and heal, but it simply can't heal. And so, just knowing that the pain was never subsiding, like an open wound. So sitting is still painful. I knew that was never happening. And I think it probably didn't help that by the time I got to the chemo date that we needed to have it done by, because there's a, you know, a pretty sharp timeline that they have. And the reason is because of when I got off of radiation to surgery, they didn't want to wait any longer to get me back on chemo. And the reason I say that is because I did have 7 to 8 spots in my liver. And the first 3 months of chemo did kill those spots. However, they didn't resect them because they were gone. So the fear was that there was microscopic disease. So they wanted to make sure chemo happened immediately. And we didn't wait for that. But I think that also, it's a pretty rough treatment, or it was for me. And I think that probably didn't help the healing process and possibly killed cells that were desperately trying to mend, and then it didn't happen.
Okay. So then when it was found out, or you realized it wasn't healing, this wasn't something that should be happening, you shouldn't have drainage for this long after the surgery, what did the doctors propose to fix it and help you out?
So it was about a year later that they finally decided, okay, let's try to do something. And at that point, my surgeon, who was the first surgeon to work on me, he had moved to another hospital. So the surgeon that stepped in for him had followed my case, and they put in a drain, hoping that the drain would, the liquid would eventually come out and it would dry. We did that. I wore a drain internally where the rectum should be for several weeks, about 3 weeks, and that it also did not work. And so then after, I want to say, 2 of those small surgeries with him, and realizing he felt at a loss, that is when I was referred to the surgical oncologist in plastics, who works with radiation damage, particularly for breast cancer patients, but he's used to seeing skin in that kind of situation, these kind of situations where he seemed to know how to deal with it. And he is essentially doing wound care in the operating room. And that is when it's taken several years of these surgeries. I think we're going on, well, this December, this coming December, so it will be 5 years from that surgery. And so it's been a lot of little surgeries, but I think they're finally on a path.
So then part of the reason that they're suspecting that things didn't heal well was because there was a lot of damage
yes.
in that area from your radiation.
Yeah. So internally, they said, you know, just imagine it. Or maybe this was my husband that said this, as he always likes says, tries to help me understand what the doctors are saying. It's kind of like Swiss cheese, what the skin is like internally. And just, it just is so damaged that it's like sewing together holes, these big holes, and it created, you know, the pelvic radiation went right through my hips, and right where the rectum was also up against the vaginal wall. So it deteriorated the vaginal wall as well. And I dealt with a fistula, which is, it's still healing. So it basically burned through, in that area and damaged everything internally. And when I say damaged, the damage caused a lot of scarring. I had to be separated again in the vagina. Everything was adhering from scars and tissue due to radiation. I had radiation enteritis, like right as I was finishing up, even my very last night before my last radiation treatment, I was in the ER from my intestines, everything kind of adhering together. So it was, radiation was brutal for me specifically. And I'm not sure if it's just how my skin is or any of that, but I don't know. But that was a brutal portion, I think, of my treatment, which caused everything from there on out to not heal correctly.
So you went in frequently for kind of like clean out surgeries to try and get that fluid out to help with the healing. And it would be like a Band-Aid on a bullet wound, kind of like it was a very temporary fix. So when was it decided that you would try the Gracilis flap surgery?
So after a few of the cleanings, and it not doing it moving the dial so slightly, that's when we decided that the cavity was, that I also was working, that they had a team working. I was working with, a female doctor as well, a gynecological oncologist, a surgical oncologist. And she realized that due to, the location of the tumor and the way the vagina was falling into this cavity, and there was also a hole there, everything kind of had to be reconstructed and moved to the right location again. And they were hoping that if we put this cavity that's now empty, that used to have, you know, normal anatomy there, is gone and is empty. And so it's just filling with fluid. And that was when they decided if we cut this flap, it would give that wall support again, but also healthy blood flow, so that the skin that was there that was so damaged, the blood flow, if they did this flap, which the Gracilis flap is where they cut the tendon at the knee and take a slice of the tendon up your leg, your inner thigh, and then they'll tuck that tendon up and through the groin, keeping it attached to healthy blood flow. So they will not detach that muscle. They'll keep it to the blood supply and tuck it into the cavity. And the hope is that healthy blood flow will fill that area and also give it healthy skin again, which it has been doing. That was in 2021 when I got that. It's just been happening extremely slowly. And at that point is when they finally took me off chemo as well, so that it could have a chance at healing without chemo impeding those like growing cells that are desperately trying to heal
right.
the wound.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously you're still healing and recovering, but as far as like getting back to kind of your normal day-to-day life, how long is that recovery time from this surgery?
From the Gracilis flap or
Yeah, from
just
the Gracilis flap.
the Gracilis flap, luckily, was not as awful as I was thinking. I was expecting another miserable surgery like the lower surgery for me. That one, for whatever reason, was, re and I've heard different stories of it not being bad for some people, and for me, it was pretty hard to bounce back from. But this one, I was up and walking, within the first few days. They want you to be up and walking on day one. But I know even 10 days out, I was out and about, sometimes holding onto a wheelchair or a walker, but I was out and about. And it was actually not a bad surgery. As it looked worse than it was, and it sounds worse than it is, but it wasn't as brutal as I thought it was going to be.
How has your treatment and this complication impacted your quality of life?
Oh, that's a good question. I would say, I'm always grateful that I'm here, but it came with a big cost. And for a lot for several years, I didn't swim. I want to say, well, it was the end of 2021 that I finally, and I was diagnosed in 2018, that I was finally allowed to swim again. Not that that was a big deal, but when you have three kids, it was kind of, you missed out on a lot in their younger years. And I would say that also, just in general of like, I can't ride a bike. I couldn't run, if I wanted to. And mainly the reason is because of that cavity. Just you, I feel the pain of the cavity that is still trying to heal like an open wound. So in certain ways, and the other thing is sexual intercourse is not really a thing at this point. It's attempted, it's not comfortable. Nothing is the same internally anymore. And the hope is that, the doctors are hoping that they can get there, and then they hope that they, that's what they're striving for, because, well, and I know we've talked about this. It's not necessarily age, older people, younger people, all of us. It's what makes us feel as a female or male. Those are the things that are just make you feel whole, and they're not able to happen normal, especially as a married, happily married person. You feel like you're not whole, and you're not being able to be who you are with your person, and so that's been also tough. It's not important. It's not, I mean, I guess it is important, but I guess what I'm saying, it's not necessarily a priority, but it just fits into your mental state of where you were to where you are now, and who you are as a person. And so that's been kind of tough mentally, I would say. So quality of life, it's not where it used to be, but it's not, I'm still here. I guess that's, it's like, it's what we all say. It's like, well, I'm still here. It sucks, but I'm still here, and I'm, for the most part, doing really well. So,
And it sounds like things are starting to improve because you went in recently to get this procedure done again with your other leg.
yeah. So actually, this past Thursday, I was supposed to go in for a second Gracilis flap. Because we're still, this past year we did five more of the small surgeries, which are the debridement surgeries to clean out the wound. And again, we have gotten very, very, very small forward movement on it. And so the thought was, if we go ahead and fill this cavity all the way up, we won't have to deal with it anymore. But we went in Thursday, and my leg, we went in for the other leg, and my doctor found that the cavity was finally starting to close. And it was, the muscle flap was finally doing its job, and therefore the surgery wasn't needed. So we did essentially another one of the surgeries we've done in the last year. And then we'll, you know, we were hoping that was my very last surgery, but likely we'll do another one or two of those to see if we can finally get this wound healed. But the good news is I didn't have to cut my other leg.
That's great. So then how often or when do they want to see you back to do potentially like another clean out?
Well, so right now I'll go to post-op on Friday, and I'm hoping, which is a little under a week. And I'm hoping that I will find out when the next one will be. My guess is my last one before this one was in December, and we were doing it like every 6 to 8 weeks and trying to just stay on top of it last year. And this time we decided to wait. I think December 12th was the last surgery that we did, and all the way till now. So I think we're going to space this one out again, knowing that we spaced this last one out, and just we won't do them so close together as we did last year. But I think my guessing is in a couple of months, we'll do it again.
Okay. And as far as treatment wise goes for your cancer, you mentioned you took a break to have this surgery. Have you still been on a break and haven't been doing active treatment? And if so, like how have they been monitoring you?
Yeah. So I will not, so ever since 2021, they took me off of the chemo pills, and I started chemo pills right after, I was done with infusion treatment. And that was basically when I was done with all of my main treatment, they started the chemo pills just to make sure that any microscopic disease would stay away. And so I was on that, it was just 2021. They took me off of that for surgery, and I haven't been back on since. And the plan is to keep me off of it. And the reason how I'm able to stay off of it is I do a Signatera blood biopsy test, which happens every 8 weeks, and they use my tumor markers from the resected tumor, and they use those markers to detect if any recurrence is happening before it even happens. So they're able to do that every 8 weeks, and then I still get my CEA and my normal blood work every 4 weeks, so I get that monthly. And then I also get quarterly scans. However, since I just hit my 5-year mark, where everything is kind of slowly spreading out. So my last scans were in December, and my next scans will probably be within the next month. So this is the first time I've had them that spread out, just because I'm finally at the 5-year mark.
Yeah. Well, so you've been cancer-free ever since then, right?
Yes. Ever since my final scans after treatment were in April, I believe, of 2019, and have been no evidence of disease since.
Yay. Well, congratulations. That's one good thing through all of this. You haven't had to worry and deal with recurrences throughout the process as well. So being on that break from the chemo pill hasn't been detrimental. It has been good to help you with healing.
Yeah, I think so. I'm hopeful anyway that that's part of what has helped me slightly move that dial forward ever since we've been off of chemo. So I'm hoping I can stay off of it. And so far it's worked. So I have to say I have an amazing oncologist, and she was very adamant about her treatment plan and kept me on that. And the plan was to keep me on it for an undetermined amount of time, but due to the fact that this wound wouldn't heal, we had to give it a try without it.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your story with us today, and I wish you continued healing and hopes that you continue to be cancer-free for a very, very long time.
Thank you, and thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming. I hope this interview has been informative. And if you're dealing with the same issues, I hope it's helped you to see that you're not the only one out there dealing with these complications. To hear more stories from stage 4 patients, you can click on the playlist right up here. Or to hear more about what you could expect when you're going in for surgery, you can click on the playlist down here. Thank you for watching.